National History Day is a program that engages over 500,000 students in high school and middle school in creating original research. This year's topic for National History Day is breaking barriers in history. And today we are joined by some amazing experts here at the National Air and Space Museum to answer your questions. Today we're joined by Dr. Peter Jacob, Chief Curator here at the National Air and Space Museum, Dr. Bob Vanderlinden, Curator in the Aeronautics Department, and Dr. Kathleen Lewis, Curator in the Space History Department. Thank you all for joining us today. My name is Marty Kelsey. I'm an educator here at the museum, and we'll be taking your questions. If you've got a question, please send them in the comments section on Facebook right at the bottom of the stream, or you can send us an email at nasmstudentquestions@si.edu, NASM student questions. Send those questions in. They're sending them to me, and we will try to get to as many of them as we can. We have had hundreds of questions submitted, and so we're going to try to get through as many of them today as we can. Are you guys ready to go?
Ready.
All right, so our first question is for you, Kathy, and it's about Apollo. Somebody wants to know, what was the reaction in the Soviet Union when the United States landed on the moon?
That is a really good question, and something that people don't think about. Of course, the Apollo moon landing was broadcast throughout the world. NASA allowed it to be relayed to everywhere that wanted it. And the best estimates of about 300 to 400 million people watched Apollo. Now, granted, this was 50 years ago when not everyone had a TV, essentially, in their pocket. So this was really rare. There were a few countries, including the former Soviet Union, that did not broadcast it publicly to their home television sets. However, they did have a broadcast inside the central television headquarters in Moscow, and a few special dignitaries did go see it, including cosmonauts who were really, they were made. They wished Armstrong, Aldrin, and Collins good luck on their launch, and they were delighted to see the landing and the first footprints on the moon. The Soviet population didn't get as much information. It was reported about the Apollo moon landing. It was on page 4. Now that might seem a really denigration to the Apollo effort, but page 4 was the standard page for international news in Soviet newspapers. But the Soviets were much more preoccupied with their efforts to send a robotic probe to the moon about the same time. So they were reporting on that progress on page 1, and page 4 they were talking about the moon landing. But I think everyone was excited, and in fact there is a backup training suit of Michael Collins that is on display and has been on display for almost 50 years at the Memorial Museum of Cosmonautics in Moscow.
Oh wow, so. That is really cool. Alright, Peter, the next question is for you about the Wright brothers. Why did they want to build the first airplane?
Well, the Wright brothers, of course, were the first to make this first sustained-powered true flight in an airplane. And you might think that that was something that they wanted to do all their lives. They watched birds as kids and dreamt about flying and all of that. It's actually not the case. The Wright brothers really got involved with aeronautics really as kind of almost a hobby, something interesting to pursue. They had, by that time, established their livelihood as bicycle makers and bicycle repair people. And particularly Wilbur, the older brother, was kind of casting about looking for a project to work on. And when they began their work in aeronautics, they didn't think they were going to invent the airplane. In fact, they write a famous letter to the Smithsonian Institution asking for information about flight. And in that letter, they say, "We hope to add our mite to the future worker who will attain final success." But once they got involved with the project and started to have some advancement to what they were doing, then they became convinced that, yeah, we're really onto something here. And at one point, about 3 years into the project, they knew they were going to invent the airplane.
That's awesome. And one of the really neat things about working on National History Day here at the museum, we've gotten a couple of letters from students asking for information. And I always think that connection to the letter the Wright brothers wrote and a student actually sending a physical letter to the museum is pretty cool. I do want to say the first question that we had was from a couple of students, and then Maya sent the other one. So we have a question about Amelia Earhart. And this one, Bob, we'll see if you can answer this one. Why did she have such a big impact at that time?
Well, she was one of the pioneer women pilots, women aviators of the time. She was very conscious of her prominence, long distance flights across the country, across the Atlantic, first woman to fly across the Atlantic, and first woman to fly across the Atlantic nonstop solo. Also only the second person to fly across the Atlantic nonstop, so 5 years the day after Lindbergh. So she made headlines. And instead of just making headlines, she did it to promote aviation, but also promote women, and not just women in aviation. And because of that, she has been a beacon ever since. And of course, her mysterious disappearance in 1937 certainly didn't squelch that interest, probably heightened it so much, but she's very much a leader.
One of the kind of random weird facts that we learn here at the museum, there's a NASA astronaut, Randy Comrade Bresnik. His grandfather was Amelia Earhart's photographer. And I always think that connection is really cool. Kathy, we've got another Apollo question, this one from Kristen. Who mainly conducted the research for the landing sites for the Apollo missions?
Well, the landing sites were a very important aspect. They had to find landing sites that were relatively safe. They didn't have to be the most, often the most geologically interesting sites, but they had to have balance, the geological interests and the safety of the astronauts. So you didn't want to send an astronaut or a team of astronauts to land on large rocks or craters or steep inclines, but you wanted to have them find something of significance. And it changed over time. It was a progression. The Apollo 11 landing was in this, what they thought was going to be the safest place. Turned out it was a little rockier than they had planned, so Neil Armstrong famously moved past that, but they wanted to collect samples and bring it back just to demonstrate the engineering prowess of the program. But by Apollo 15, 16, 17, they were able to go further, look for more interesting rocks, and the astronauts themselves were trained. This was conducted by earth scientists and geologists in the University of Arizona in Hawaii. So there were a number of people who were called in to work on this to train the astronauts who were not geologists, with one exception, Harrison Schmidt, to train them to be geologists and to what to look for. You know, because of humans, you have the capability of looking down, making a decision, making a choice between the rock over there and the rock to your left, the rock to your right, and the rock to your left just happens to be orange. Ah, the geologist told me that's what I'm looking for. That's a primary, that indicates that it has elements that are very important and it will help increase our understanding of how the moon developed.
Awesome. Don't forget, if you're watching, send questions in the comments section on Facebook or to the email address nasmstudentquestions@si.edu. We'll be taking as many as we can get to. Peter, the next one's for you from Mr. Coleman's class. Can you talk a little bit about some of the problems that the Wright brothers faced in inventing that first airplane?
Well, you know, the most important thing to remember about the invention of the airplane is it wasn't just one invention, but it was many inventions, all which had to work together. Today we have a term for that. We call it a technological system, where you have all the components that work together. And if you think about an airplane, that's what it is. It's a system. You've got to have a set of wings to get you in the air. You have to have a control system to be able to control the airplane once it's in the air, a propulsion system to keep it going. Even the pilot is part of the system that controls the airplane. So the Wright brothers are really the first ones to understand that that's what an airplane was, and that they had to solve all of these different problems. Many of their contemporaries and predecessors focused on one thing first and didn't worry about the others until they solved that. So they had many problems to solve, and they did the research to achieve a solution for each one of those things and then put it all together.
Cool. Now, the image that's up on the screen right now, I want to point something out because I was blown away the first time this was shown to me. This is the very famous image of the first flight, and I always assumed that the first flight, the plane had a really long run-up and then took off. But if you look in this image, just a few feet back from where it's in the air, you will see the footprints around where the wing was that morning as they were walking around getting everything ready. And it didn't have to go very far before it took to the air. And I think this is a really cool way to use images to learn from, you know, these historic images that we always see, but maybe looking a little deeper into them.
But the reason for that was, yes, because it was very, very windy that day. It was almost 30 miles an hour,
wow,
the wind when they were taking off. And there's two types of speed with an airplane. There's airspeed, which is the speed of the airplane going through the air, and there's ground speed, the speed of the airplane relative to the ground. Now, their airspeed was close to 30 miles an hour because the wind was so strong, but their ground speed was just about 6 miles an hour, which is why you see Wilbur there on the right hand of the picture kind of just jogging along next to the airplane, because relative to the ground, it wasn't going very fast. But the airplane didn't know that because the wind was going so fast over the wings.
And this is, that's the same concept, Bob, that happens on an aircraft carrier, right? You have to have a certain amount of wind coming across the deck to be able to take off and land?
Well, when you're on an aircraft carrier, they're always point the ship into the wind. For that matter, every airplane that ever takes off is pointed into the wind, which is why you have different runways in different directions at different airports. You take off into the wind. You don't have to on a really long runway, but it helps.
Awesome. All right, so Bob, the next one's for you. We've got a couple of World War II questions here. So Manny wants to know, why were the Devastator torpedo bombers not tested before they were launched into battle?
They were tested before they were launched into battle. And they had been in combat since the war started. They actually did reasonably well. The big problem with the Devastator was its bad torpedo. It would not hit anything. It would circle around. It would go below the ship. It was a dreadful torpedo. It took them 2 or 3 years to get a different, to improve it, make it work. And after that, it was effective. By that time, the Devastator had been replaced. I'm sure that question is about the Battle of Midway, and particularly torpedo bomber 8, the squadron that was completely wiped out. And they were completely wiped out. But they were completely wiped out because they were flying low on the deck, as you're supposed to, slow, because you have to, especially with a bad torpedo. They had to do about 100 miles an hour. And the Japanese fire cover saw them and went down to attack them. And while they were attacking the Devastators and destroying all of them, the Dauntless dive bombers, which you see on the screen here, made their attack on the carriers, and they were untouched, and they sank 4 carriers.
So the planes that we see on the screen right now were kind of the heroes of the Battle of Midway?
Well, the SBDs, yes, they were. But and people think the Devastators failed. They didn't in that, I mean, without that top cover being brought down, the Japanese would have shredded those Dauntlesses as well.
Wow. All right, so we've got more questions coming in. Michael Morin's class, is there any competition between the U.S. and other countries that affect space exploration now?
There remains competition between the United States, Russia, and all of the world's spacefaring nations. They're competing not only to be first anymore, but also for markets and in commerce. There's competition among GPS satellites, global positioning and navigation satellites, communication satellites. There's all sorts of peacetime in applications competition, but there's also competition for war military applications in space. There's this notion that we have to maintain our superiority. We have to have every country has their own independent communications and navigation system. And in some cases, in the United States, it's used both for civilian and military. In other countries, it's only military. But every nation involved is competing, and not only those who have launch capability. Countries that purchase their launch capability based on and have satellites that they've made or purchased from multinational corporations launched into space. So they have a unique ability to operate their own phone systems, operate their own navigation systems, broadcast their own TVs. Recently, Russia launched from Baikonur in Kazakhstan a Spanish television communication satellite that was not made in Spain. It was made as part of a European consortium. So you have all of these countries cooperating and competing against each other at the same time. It's really quite complex.
Awesome. Speaking of complex, Peter, let's go back to the Wright brothers. They built bicycles before. How did that influence the design of that very first airplane?
You know, having experience with a bicycle, which might surprise you, had a lot of impact on inventing the airplane. One of the reasons for that, perhaps the most important reason for that, is if you think about a bicycle, it's totally unstable, right? If you run a bicycle without a person sitting on it, it'll fall over, right? And it has to have constant controls input from the rider to keep it upright. So it's a completely unstable machine, but it's an entirely controllable machine. And that was really kind of an important breakthrough concept for the Wright brothers, to think about an airplane like that, that you could have an airplane that was unstable, but still controllable. Most of the experimenters up to the time of the Wright brothers thought that you had to have a totally stable airplane, that a human being couldn't have reflexes fast enough to control it, that it had to be inherent, what was known as inherently stable, that if a gust of wind tipped it up, it would sort of right itself. But the Wright brothers sort of freed themselves from that restriction, realizing that just because something is unstable, you can still control it. And all airplanes are like that. Some are more stable than others, but the ability to have independence between the control system and the stability of the airplane was key to the Wright brothers. And the bicycle provided that inspiration.
Awesome. Bob, we've got one about the Bell X1. What happened to the British Miles M52 project? Was it abandoned, or did they simply get beaten?
It was canceled by the British government. I mean, there are people out there that believe the conspiracy theory that we put pressure on the British to cancel. We didn't. It was expensive. They were going to use a jet engine rather than a rocket engine, and they were developing it, but they thought it was not in their interest to do so, and so they canceled it. The X1 was not a copy. I've heard that before. It looks similar, but you get similar designs designed to similar design criteria. And
why was this plane and breaking the sound barrier, why was that so important?
Well, what it was really was a transonic research aircraft. The Air Force intended it to go supersonic. The NACA did too eventually. But what the industry needed was data on transonic flight, flying between 0.8 Mach, which is the speed of sound, 0.8 times the speed of sound, and about 1.2 Mach. They had plenty of data up to that because they had good wind tunnels. They actually had data beyond 1.2. What they didn't have was that window right in there, which frankly is where all airliners fly today. So the NACA, the predecessor to NASA, they built three of them. There was some controversy between the Air Force and the NACA. They kind of went their separate ways, but the Air Force wanted to go as fast as possible, see if they could break the so-called barrier. There was no barrier because of military reasons. You know, they want to build the next generation of fighters, need to be as fast as possible to maintain an advantage over the Soviet Union. And that did happen. In the meantime, while the NACA was flying their other one, both of them gathered a great deal of data, and which was very useful in the first generation of jet airliners.
Awesome. All right, this next question comes in from Braden, who coincidentally actually goes to the school that I used to teach at, South Middle School. So Braden, thanks for the question. And he wants to know, and I thought this was really cool, what was Yuri Gagarin's flight like? Like, what was it like to be in that capsule if you were Yuri Gagarin?
Well, if you were Yuri Gagarin, first of all, you'd be very short. Yuri Gagarin was about a little bit shorter than my height. He was chosen, and the first cosmonauts were chosen by size just to pick out pilots who were small enough to fit in their proposed capsule. It was not very big. He was strapped in his spacesuit, sealed into the capsule, launched, made a single orbit of the Earth, and was automatically returned to Earth. So he didn't have any ability to operate the spacecraft while he was in orbit. And it was also really quick. It was 90 minutes from start to finish. That was proving the point that a human being could survive the launch into space, survive the speed that required the 17,500 miles an hour, and also survive returning back to Earth. Gagarin's flight, as I said, was 90 minutes, but before that 90 minutes was up, at 20,000 feet, he had to eject from the spacecraft. This was a little known fact at the time, because the spacecraft hadn't been designed to have soft landing engines to allow them to land a human being safely inside the spacecraft. They'd use the similar capsule for landing animals, but they could slow that down enough and cushion the animals well enough. But Gagarin had to parachute down. So as part of that 90 minutes was parachuting down from 20,000 feet inside the spacecraft. He was ejected out of his capsule in his couch. The couch separated and had its own parachute, and then he came down separately. So it was a rocky mission. He only had a few minutes of actual space flight. When you think of it, it takes 9 minutes to get into orbit, and then that last few minutes of ejection and preparing for ejection, you've always got to remember, keep your elbows inside. You don't want to lose any limbs as you come out. So it was a very exciting time, but no one had done this before. This was an amazing feat. He remains a global hero. We celebrate Yuri's Night every year on April 12th to celebrate that mission.
Awesome. All right, Peter, we've got another question from Facebook. Chauncey wants to know about the connection between the Wright brothers and Paul Lawrence Dunbar.
Paul Lawrence Dunbar was a historic figure in his own right. He was a very prominent African-American poet in the late 19th, early 20th century. But he was also a high school classmate of Orville Wright. They went to high school together in Dayton, Ohio, and they were friends. And one of the things that the Wright brothers did before they got involved with aviation, even before they got involved with bicycles, was they were printers. They printed pamphlets and leaflets and things like that, but they also printed local newspapers. And Paul Lawrence Dunbar had started a small little paper for the African American community in Dayton, Ohio. And Orville printed the paper for his friend Paul Lawrence Dunbar.
That's
so
really
two historic figures kind of crossing paths and then accomplished great things in other fields.
Nice. All right, Bob, Maya wants to know more about Amelia Earhart and her creating the 99s. Like, what was the hope that she had in doing that?
Well, that was to creating the 99s was it's to promote aviation to women. Which they did. The organization still exists. Of course, she was one of the first 99 pilots to sign up and was the leader of it for many years. That's about it. I mean, it achieved its purpose because, you know, they were excluded from most aeronautical events, aviation events, and they proved very clearly that the airplane doesn't care who's flying it. And they proved very clearly that they were highly competent pilots and just put those myths to rest very quickly.
Great. All right, we've got a space race question from David, and he wants to know if the two countries spied on each other.
Yes, absolutely. Of course. There was spying done at every level. We were spying on each other using aircraft. Especially the United States used the U-2 aircraft to watch the progression of Soviet launch facilities. After the Francis Gary Powers plane was shot down, the one really interesting diplomatic issue about the launch of Sputnik was that it erased the question about flying over other nations from space. And in fact, Eisenhower wasn't stunned or upset about the launch of Sputnik. It was actually relieved him of the having to be the first person to fly something over another country. So once the Soviet Union had done that, it was no longer an issue. It was a de facto, yes, we can fly other things, and that led to the first spy satellites. So we were looking down. There's a reconnaissance of on the ground. We had spies who were infiltrating Soviet operations during that time. Soviets were easily spied on us because most of what we did was open source. It was not classified for the civilian space program. And we both sides had defectors. And sometimes they crossed each other. They're defectors who came from the Soviet Union to the United Kingdom. At the same time, the Cambridge spies were operating and giving information and reporting back to the Soviet Union what the defectors were telling. the Americans and the British at the time. So there are whole layers of spying and espionage that went on during that time.
Interesting.
And still does. I mean, at every case, there still is.
Well, if you're interested in spies, STEM in 30, the TV show produced here at the National Air and Space Museum for middle school students, our February episode is all about spy planes. Be sure to check that out. We'll put the link down in the comments section. Peter and Bob, this one's for you. Constantine wants to know about the roles of the different airplanes during World War II, but that actually had its start in World War I, right?
Well, the airplane, of course, was invented in 1903, and just about 10 years later, the First World War began in 1914, and that was really the first extensive use of airplanes as a military weapon. In World War I, air power really didn't have a tremendous impact on the outcome of the war, but it had very far-reaching implications because it was really kind of the laboratory for inventing military air power. All the different missions, fighter airplanes, bomber airplanes, reconnaissance airplanes, ground attack airplanes, and all of the support that goes along with that were really worked out in the First World War. And in the Second World War, aviation really does become a very influential factor in the outcome of the war. But all of those basic missions had been pioneered in the First World War. I don't know, Bob, if you want to pick that up.
No, that's it. You know, basically, that's just the case. One thing in World War I, reconnaissance actually very early on had a definite effect. I mean, yes, the war dragged on for 4 years and the lines didn't move, but a second battle of the Marne, Well, there was reconnaissance that noticed that the Germans were turning in front of Paris, saved Paris, and they recognized that. And on the Eastern Front, German reconnaissance saw that the two Russian armies were split and allowed the Germans to defeat the Russians at Tannenberg, changed the whole course of the war.
How was the training different for the different types of airplanes? I mean, a pilot, you learn to fly one, can you fly the next? For a, you know, crew, is it the same? I mean, is that skill transfer, or was that very specific to the types of airplanes?
World War I?
World War II, World War I, either one.
Well, flying is flying, but you still have to, you know, when you get in a bigger airplane, its size is significant. A fighter aircraft obviously is much more maneuverable. It's less stable on purpose. Transport planes are not unstable, at least they better not be. But pilots would quite often make a transition. They would have to go through training to do so. But it's more learning the different systems of the airplane, multiple engines versus a single engine, that sort of thing.
And it wasn't just pilots. On a bomber airplane, you have a navigator, you have the bombardier, you have gunners, you have a whole different range of jobs on the same airplane. So it's not only pilots who are part of air power.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I think one of the most interesting things to do is to look at, you know, the pilots on an aircraft carrier. They're the tip of the iceberg. It takes so many, you know, thousands of people to keep that aircraft running, even down to the chefs. All right, Kathy, we've got one for you. Valentina Tereshkova, how did she overcome the gender barrier to become that first woman in space?
The flight of Valentina Tereshkova in June 1963 was a very special occasion. The crew of the team of cosmonauts who were selected to be part of the Women's Brigade were selected specifically after the initial team of male cosmonauts. And the largely in the eyes of Soviet leader Nikita Khrushchev and Sergei Korolev, who was the manager, the chief designer of the space program, they decided that they wanted to demonstrate that even a woman could fly. This has echoes of flights, of women's flights that had occurred during the 1930s. In the Soviet Union and demonstrating that aviation was an important part of the industrial base of the Soviet Union, and even women could fly. They had women cross-country flights that echoed what men had been doing a few years before. So this idea was a matter-of-fact normal idea. There had been a wish that they would have continued flights after that. And in fact, they kept the Women's Brigade, and they were five women. Until 1969 is when they were de facto disbanded, but they were not officially disbanded until 1972. And they thought about having another women's flight, having a multiple crew women's flight, but alas, they did nothing until they heard that the United States was going to launch women. So they launched Svetlana Savitskaya to preempt Sally Ride's flight, and then they sent her up again to do a spacewalk a few years later to preempt Kathy Sullivan's spacewalk. So it was an opportunistic flight going back to Tereshkova, but it was also this way of demonstrating that a technology was stable, useful, and reliable, so even a woman could fly. It's unfortunate because it does disservice to the women who flew in the Soviet Union during World War II, and they were all very accomplished flyers. They flew night runs, and they were brigades of them, and fighters were known as the Night Witches. To the Germans, they flew transport, like many American women flew during the war. But they are were set aside in history because this dramatic sign of, this picture of a woman in space really overshadowed their accomplishments. And they were not among any of the women who were chosen for these first flights. And in fact, there was one woman in the first five who was an up-trained pilot to begin with. And at the time when Savitskaya was chosen to do that preemptive space flight to the Salyut space station, she was chosen not only because she was an aerobatic pilot, but also because her father was a marshal of the Soviet Air Forces. So she was a well-known pilot, even though her piloting skills weren't needed at that time.
Kearney, that was a great question. I do want to share a resource with everybody. The Smithsonian Online Virtual Archive, or SOVA, is a great place to start your research. We are constantly digitizing different resources that we have. I know right now they're working on the Sally Ride collection. It's a pretty massive collection. You can go in there, you can see the things that we've got digitized, and can really help with research that you're doing. So I encourage you to check that out. I'd like to thank our panelists today. You guys were awesome. Thank you so much. For those of you working on National History Day projects, good luck. We hope you have great projects, and we can't wait to see the final results. We'd also like to thank Boeing for bringing this program to you today. Thanks for watching.